The next speaker is Sam Fiorini, and he will speak about integer programs matching the topic with bounded subdeterminants and two non-zeros per row. Welcome, Sam.
Okay, thanks a lot, Pete. Thanks a lot to the organizers for giving the talk and also for inviting me to the MSF program. So this particular paper is a joint work with Gwenaëlle Jauret from Brussels, Stefan Welger from Munich, and Lena Yuditsky, who was a postdoc with me in Brussels. So Lena, so that's Gwen, and this is Lena, Stefan, you know. But this is also like the final outcome of a longer project, 3 years project, even more, maybe 4 years. And I was working on this with Michele Conforti and Tony Hein.
Is this picture from his house? Or where
yes,
is it?
Yes, this is the Conforti Institute of Mathematics.
Okay.
So there is this beautiful lake there, Garda Lake, in the north of Italy. Okay, so that's the story of my talk in one picture. So we will start with an open problem in integer programming. Then we want to build a bridge between that and graph minus. So we go to graph minus, extend some results there, and then basically walk back towards IP, make ourselves a parachute, and base jump from the middle of the bridge. So
in 30 minutes.
In 30 minutes, yes. Try to do it. Okay. So that's the outline of my talk. So after an introduction, I will straight give you the structural theorem for the graphs that we care about, then give you the algorithm in case the graphs have also a bounded genus, and then I will go back to the general case and give you an idea of the algorithm there. Okay, so there are two parameters that are relevant for this talk. It's not the same delta as in Michael's talk. This is, so delta of V for me is the maximum absolute value of the determinant of a square submatrix of the matrix. So you take an integer matrix A and you can compute this delta of V. At least you can define it. So delta of A at most one, this is the same as the matrix being totally unimodular. Delta of A at most two is the same as saying that the matrix is totally bimodular and so on. And there is also a graph parameter that's important for us. It's the OCP of a graph. That's the odd cycle packing number. So that's the maximum number of vertex disjoint odd cycles in the graph. Mm-hmm. So these two parameters are connected in the case where A is an instance matrix, so it's not the same matrix as Dan, so this is a transpose matrix, and there are no signs, but so you have one row per edge and one column per vertex, and in these matrices it is easy to see that the maximum subdeterminant is a power of 2, is 2 to the OCP, the idea being that if you take a packing of odd cycles, and so these two cycles, each cycle gives you a block matrix with determinants plus minus 2, and then if you take the blocks together, you get 2 to the OCP. Okay, so we prove two theorems. One about IPs, one about graphs. Okay, so let me start with the one about IPs. So for every constant delta, we can solve in strongly polytime IPs of this form. So maximize the value transpose X such that X less than B, X integer, provided that this constraint matrix A is totally delta modular, and in addition contains at most two non-zero entries in each row. There's also the column version that we can prove, but I won't talk about that here. So like some people in this room and maybe online probably dream of just proving this theorem without the second condition. We don't know how to do that. This implies a second theorem. If you take A to be an instance matrix and B to be the all one vector, you end up with a stable set problem. So we prove, that's a corollary of the first theorem, that for every constant k, there is a strongly polytime algorithm for the weighted stable set problem in the graphs with OCP at most k. Okay, so actually, interestingly, in the paper, we prove the second theorem, and we actually reduce the first one to the second one using some, like, I would say, standard results and ideas in IT. So I actually won't talk about that here. So I will just focus on the stable set problem.
Actually, stupid question. If you say at most three non-zero entries, would that somehow capture everything?
That's not clear because
the delta is not clear. Yeah,
but I don't know how to do that controlling the delta.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So some pointers to the previous work. So the maximum stable set problem in graphic small OCP has, it was known there was a p task for constant OCP by Tazari. Then you can actually let the OCP grow up to almost square root 10 and still have a p task with a different algorithm. This is due to Bock, Faenza, Moldenhauer, and Ruth Vargas, an EPFL team. So I know someone who might have inspired this research. Anyway, so for IPs, but of course, if the matrix is TU, we know how to do it. And now, actually, if the matrix is totally bimodular, so TU meant totally modular, so now you should go to the next value of delta, delta equal to 2, you end up with a totally bimodular matrix. And still, there is a beautiful algorithm by Hartmann, Weiss-Mantel, and Zenklusen, who can solve the IP in a strongly polytime. Then, in some model where you fix A and W and you let B vary, there is an algorithm that solves almost all of the IPs. This is a recent result by Patch, Dutter, and Weiss-Mantel. Then maybe a nice connection to the first workshop in this trimester program is that if you have a polyhedron defined by AX less than B, then the diameter is bounded by polynomial in delta in the dimension. I think the bound gets better if you know this is bounded, but this is the one, I guess, the bound for the unbounded case. And that's a result by Boniface, Isuma, Fritz, Eisenbrand, Handler, and Meyer. And maybe the last way that I want to mention, actually we use in the paper is this LP algorithm by Tardosh that's polynomial in the dimension of the matrix and log of delta. Okay, so let me go to the structural theorem unless there's any question. No questions. Okay. So we have a graph with bounded OCP, and actually also assuming that the odd cycle transversal is high, so there is no small set of vertices such that when you remove them you get a biperfect graph. So it's kind of an interesting graph with the bounded OCP. So there will be a bounded genus surface on which we'll try to embed the graph. And we can embed part of the graph on the surface. Now we cannot embed all of the graph in the surface always. There will be some parts of the graph that we have to draw in disks, okay, where actually you can have edge crossings. So those are the large vertices. So there's going to be some conditions on these large vertices that I will explain later, but for now let me just say that they have some nice cut sets of bounded size that we will use in the algorithm. The number of large vertices is bounded. Okay. And possibly, in addition to that, you have a possibly unbounded number of small vortices, so it's exactly like the large vortices. All these disks, so all these vertices are in disks that are all disjoint. And the difference between small and large vortices is the number of vertices of the graph on the boundary. So if you have at most three of vertices on the boundary, you are small, and otherwise you are large. Okay. And like finally, you can have a bounded number of apices. So those are maybe like the very high degree vertices that you don't want to even try to embed in the surface. So these vertices actually will typically just not worry about them because we can guess the stable set there.
So just the part sticking out.
So this, that's like this is a cross cap. So I mean, this is supposed to indicate that the surface we're taking is non-orientable.
Okay.
So for those of you who know graph miners, this is exactly a result for. This is exactly the large three-width excluded minor theorem, which is no coincidence. But in our case, we need to do some extra step. We need to actually to mine about some other things. We need to make sure, for instance, that not all of the odd cycles land up in one of these vortices. So you don't want like the odd cycle packing somehow has some significant part of in the surface. This is going to be important if you look at the details, which I won't be able to get.
Well, you couldn't repeat what you just said. So what's important? That the odd cycles they're separated?
Like, without saying that, actually, the theorem could just be trivial because you could just embed everything in there.
Okay.
So, but you cannot do that because like there will be some odd cycles living on the surface. Mm-hmm. Okay. We use some results from graph miners, in particular, like the very recent one by Karabachi, Thomas, and Warren. Let me flash that very quick. And now I can give you the algorithm, almost the full algorithm for the bounded genus case. Also in a picture. So you have now a graph that is completely embedded in a surface. And what we showed in the SODA 2020 paper is that after deleting a bounded number of vertices, you can have some property about the odd cycles that are in your graph. So every odd cycle in the graph, we can assume defines a Möbius band in the surface. So it's a one-sided cycle. So there are actually two possibilities for a cycle. If you think about it, it could either define a cylinder or a Möbius band, and we can avoid all these odd cycles that define cylinders because they have the Eder-Sprocher property. That's what we show. So we can clean a bit the embedding. Okay, so these vertices that we delete are bounded number of them, so we can guess a stable set on them. It's not a big deal. Now, if we zoom in the graph, so we look at the graph, like a very small part of that graph embedded in the surface, it's a bipartite graph, which is planar.
Sorry, so this means that every odd cycle is non-contractible?
No.
It's not this band?
Now you could have like two-sided cycles which are not compatible.
Yeah, but every odd cycle will be non-contractible.
Yes. Yeah. All right. So let's look at the dual of the graph. So using that fact that odd cycles are one-sided, we can orient that to a dual graph in such a way that around every vertex of the dual, you have, if you go around it, you have alternatively an in edge, an out edge, an in edge, an out edge. So they alternate around the vertex. Right. So we can do that. So another way to state this property is that if you take any phase of the dual corresponding, for instance, to this primary vertex, you have a directed cycle. Okay. Now let's take a stable set. This is a feasible solution to a problem. And okay, let's look again at the dual. And what I want to do is to paint in blue some stuff. So for every vertex, for every blue vertex that I took in the stable set, I want to paint in blue all the arcs of the directed cycle corresponding to the phase, you know, that defines this, that this vertex defines. Okay, so okay, so for that vertex, I painted these four arcs, and I do the same for all the vertices that I have in my stable set. So it's a bunch of disjoint directed cycles. Let me remove them from my graph. What do I get? Well, I had a circulation before, so like I had a Eulerian connected graph, which was a dual graph. I removed a bunch of directed cycles. I get circulation. And actually, it's not too hard to see that you can go back and forth between the stable set and the circulation. This is just a change of variables, actually. And this circulation is not any circulation, it has to satisfy some properties. So what we saw is that you can obtain the circulation by basically, like from the one-on-one circulation by removing facial cycles. And in topology, this is the concept of homology, actually. So your circulation has to be homologous to the all-one circulation. We want a mean cost circulation that is homologous to the all-one circulation. Okay, circulation has to be in a negative integer. And that's a problem that we have to solve. So we just translated the maximum stable set problem into that problem. We have to solve that problem now. And we can actually do that in poly time. So we had a kind of ad hoc algorithm in the Soda paper, and then still in Soda, but 1 year later, Zara, Ina, and Stefan came up with a bit more cleaner algorithm for this. Actually, there is a question I want to ask about this later. Okay, so now let's go back to the general case. We have now a graph that has bounded OCP. So we don't know, we can embed it in the surface. We have some extra stuff. So what now do we do? I have to tell you more now about these large vertices, the small vertices, okay, and the edges, we know we can forget about them. So about the large vertices, each of them, so we know we have a bounded number of them, but each of them has a linear decomposition of bounded addition, meaning that if you take any large vertex, you can map the vertices inside to intervals with integer endpoints, such a way that for every edge inside your vertex, the two corresponding intervals overlap. And like the number of ticks here is just the number of vertices on the boundary. And what is bounded is the adhesion, so that's the maximum number of intervals that cross from I to I plus one. But those are basically the cut sets that I was telling you before. Okay. That was about the large vertices. About the small vertices now, they can be replaced by gadgets. So you can show, we did that in an IPCO paper 1 year ago, that you can replace every one of these small vertices by very simple gadgets that can be drawn on the surface, which are either a subdivided edge or subdivided Y. And these actually come with some costs on the edges, but guarantee that this instance there is equivalent to the original one. Okay, so then when you clean things a bit, you are left with a graph on the surface plus a bounding number of vortices. And you can assume that these large vortices are far bound, and also that all are bipartite. Now, okay, so now I'd like to tell you about the algorithm. So this is a dynamic program that is trying to understand how the solution looks like. And we use, for that, we use the skeleton of the solution that we call the sketch. So this is again our graph and the solution, so a stable set. But okay, so there's some gray stuff, and you can see there a bit easier. So the gray boxes are supposed to be the large vortices, and in the large vortices you have stuff that I didn't represent because I wanted to just to look at the skeleton of the solution. So we know this is some circulation. The circulation actually can uncross it. So you just, okay, so go from there to there, you can uncross the circulation. And now if you look at what you have a bounding number of supernodes, and some curves that connect them, which is like the skeleton of the solution. And that's exactly what DP is trying to guess.
So the entire curve, or just the connectivity between the, like, what is it trying to guess?
So, I mean, so what we tried very, in the beginning is just to guess the whole sketch, but this you cannot really do. Because, okay, you have a bounding number of vertices, and your graph is embedded in the surface, actually, but you don't have a bounded number of these curves. You can have like many, 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 many loops that do strange things. So I mean, it's just too much to guess. So what we actually do is look at phases of this sketch, and every phase we show has a bounded complexity. So the phases are basically the cells in the DP table. So the DP is trying to build a solution by adding one curve at a time. Okay, let me show you the slide.
How much about the curve do you need to know?
Good question. So maybe I can go back here. So we need to know the starting edge, we need to know the final edge, and we need to know the contribution to the homology constraints of the curve. And this is not too much information. And then we just run this homologous flow subroutine, and it will discover a curve for us, or something that's as good as this curve.
Yeah.
That's what we do. Okay, so the DP is going down the DP table, you guess more and more of these curves. Each time you guess one, as Dan was asking, you just actually guess the starting edge and the final edge, the homology contribution, and also you guess the stable set inside the corresponding cut set. So you make one guess, another guess, and so on. So at this point, like when I add this, actually, I create two faces. Like before that, I just had one face. Now I create two faces, and now the DP, the value of the DP cell is going to be expressed as a function of the values of like pairs of cells corresponding to the faces, like by this face and the outside face, and then you continue in making your guesses, and then at some point you're happy. Okay, you have some circulation that could resemble a solution. To complete this to a solution, you actually need to, inside each large vortex, compute some maximum weight stable set between consecutive cut sets. But this is just a bipartite problem. That's easy.
So what are the corresponding cut sets when you had, you said, yeah, like.
You have this linear decomposition, right? So maybe I have to, yeah, that's a good question too. What are the cut sets? So you can basically think of this large vortex just to be the boundary of the face. So if you take two consecutive vertices on the boundary of this large vortex, this is like U2, U3, you can think of just being like one edge of the boundary of the face. Okay, so that edge would have like a cut set which is basically just you know, these intervals that cross from 2 to 3.
Uh-huh.
Like I'm slightly lying, but this is the most
likely.
Okay, so I need to finish. So yeah, that's the way the DP works. That's a summary of all I said, but we can skip to the open question. So the obvious one is, can you solve IPs with bounded delta in polytime? I don't know, but I really like this question to solve sometime soon. What about FPT algorithms? Well, our algorithm is not FPT at all. It is an axial algorithm with quite a bad dependence actually on the parameters. Now, I mean, you can ask about the existence of FPT algorithms for the problems. Maybe the easiest one is when you also bound the genus. So you assume that your graph has bounded OCP and bounded genus. And for that, the bottleneck is this homologous flow computation on the surface. And it's okay. So it's, you are computing homologous flows on a bijective graph that is on a non-orientable surface. And actually, if you just change the problem description a bit, so if you take your graph to be non-directed, or you take your surface to be orientable, then the FPT algorithms. So that if you like make the table of all cases, basically the four cases, and it's like the one we need is the only one for which you don't have an FPT algorithm that is known. But we also don't know about the lower bound there, and actually we didn't really spend any time thinking about this. So that might be the outcome that you cannot do this. But yeah, I'd like to know. So, yeah, thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.